you so much. Welcome. I greet you all in the name of Jesus this afternoon. God bless you wherever you are watching us from. Thank you because you are there. And I know God is going to speak to us again as he has been doing though before. Today is another day that God is going to bless us with his word because he has prepared his servant, our bishop, to come and continue teaching us the authority and our position in him. Hallelujah. And I know God is going to impart in us what he has for us this afternoon. I welcome you in the name of Jesus that God is going to speak to us and give you hope in him through the word he has put in our bishop. And therefore, let's prepare ourselves to hear the word of God, because today, Lord, the Lord is going to change our way of thinking. He's going to help us to understand his authority on us and the position he has given us through the word in the name of Jesus. We want to pray as we welcome our bishop this afternoon. And as you prepare with your Bible and your notebook, know that God loves you so much. We welcome you in Jesus' name. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you because you are good and faithful. This is another day that God, you have made so that you can speak to us and you impart in us your knowledge of your word through our bishop. And how we pray that God, you're going to help us to know you and to understand you and to know the authority that we have in us and the position you have given us through your word. We thank you and we worship you. Holy Spirit, speak to every person watching us. Let the word have an impartation in our lives and in the way we do things for your glory and for your honor. We pray for our bishop, even him. Bless him as he continues teaching and speaking your word to your people. We thank you and we worship you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Welcome, Bishop, in the name of Jesus.
To God be the glory, great things he has done. And we want to continue with the message, not as usual, but in a different level of glory. Our message is clear authority and position. I'm Bishop Peter Katimo. I know the truth. You are part of me. I sense the love of God in my heart towards you. I sense the anointing in my heart being released into your situation. Receive breakthrough and healing. I say receive your healing now. However you are, be healed. That headache be healed. Those legs be healed. That son who got lost be restored back. That marriage be healed. Oh, I destroy the darkness that reigns over your life. I remove it now. Receive the cover and the glory of the living God. Now, we want to continue with our message. One thing I would like us to, we are on the clear authority and position. That is part two. Now, part three. Let's go to the book of Daniel. And we see how a clear authority and position was built up by God when the wise, young, intelligent Jews, Hebrews, captured alongside other Jews. And maybe the king decided, let me take these intelligent Jews so that I can train them to be part of the wise men, that group, that fleet, that group that worked around in the palace. And now, and I thank God, you know, the king decided to change their names, do a lot of orientation to see whether Daniel and the other brothers will change completely their culture, their exposure, their training, their foundation, the structures of life, and make them Babylonians by faith, culture, and knowledge, and whatever. And when one thing that you God want is that no one should change you from Jesus Christ, and you should not by any means join people. There are people who you believe in Christ and you get married to an antichrist. That one should not happen. It is incompatible. Faith is important in marriage. Jesus is Lord over your marriage. You can't throw away Jesus at the expense of getting just a young man into. Let Jesus be honored by your choices. And that's why if you check on these people, let's read these scriptures. In Daniel chapter 1 verse 8. Bible says that after these people were taken to Babylon, and the king said they be taught the language and the literature of Babylon and changed them completely from their faith and culture, he also appointed for them a daily provision of his, what we call, king's delicacies, and of the wine which he drank, and 3 years of training for them, so that at the end they might serve before the king. You know, there was Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And the Bible says something now. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's delicacies, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested for an alternative menu. Simple. But you see, one of the problems with some Christians is that when you go to a more civilized place, you feel like the faith you have should also bow to the new level of status. You go to a new city where they have these big things, big people with money and whatever. You can't start there and say, I cannot defile myself. You are afraid of telling that boss, that CEO, that big man, that more educated person, that I cannot defile myself. And most of the people have lost the precious faith because of elevating things above Christ, who is bigger than this Savior. All knees shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. He is the one that John saw in Revelation chapter 21. He says, and I saw something, a great white throne coming from heaven, and he who will be sitting on that big throne, heavens and earth will disappear before him. Yes, heavens, the people you see, the buildings you see, the magnificent development you see, they are good beneath them. But Jesus is above them. And when he descended at the white throne judgment, which will be the end judgment in the Bible. Bible says heavens and earth will disappear before him. And their places, the places of what you see around, and what you see in the skies, galaxies, the places of all these things will never be there anymore. And therefore, that's why God would like to put in your mind his level of glory, so that no other glory can compare to what you have seen in God. That's why Paul says, if you read in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, as Paul narrates his testimony and his experiences, if you go all over to chapter 12, he says, and one day somebody was taken to the first, to the third heaven. And Paul says, and the things I saw there are so glorious that God has forbidden me not to say them when I'm in the flesh. You're in the flesh, but carrying in you surpassing revelation of glory. And that's what Paul would say. The glory that will be revealed when Christ comes cannot be compared with the sufferings that we are undergoing. And therefore, Paul says, nothing will separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. That's how we operate, friends. And that's why now you see Daniel saying, I cannot. Even if it's the king who said it, even if he is the most powerful king, Nebuchadnezzar was compared in In Daniel chapter 2 and Daniel chapter 7, he was compared to lion, strongest creature, animal in the jungle. He was compared in chapter 7 of Daniel, lion, chapter 2, the head, the gold. But Daniel, in exile, said, we cannot defy ourselves. Let's have what we choose, but not what they choose. And God heard it. The favor of God upon Daniel started that day in a bigger way. If you go to Daniel chapter 2, Daniel comes around and say, now, king want to kill. Get rid of everybody in the palace, the wise people, astrologers, mediums, whoever they are, diviners. Get rid of their families because they have been unable to remind the king the dream he had at night and interpret it. But Daniel comes and says, king, don't kill people. Stop it. I will consult the God of heaven and I'm coming back to you. And Daniel comes and says, Mr. King, whatever you wanted can only be known from the throne of God, from God, who is El Shaddai, always Almighty God. Yes, and I've come to tell you the dream and the interpretation. Daniel chapter 3, verse 16, 17, and 18. Abednego, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. The king says, I'm the one who determines what people should worship. He set up a golden image and says, all the world bow to this one. And Shadrach says, no, we can't. Even if you are the strongest king, we cannot bow. We cannot bow. And the king says, can you make a fiery furnace and make the fire hot, more strong, more hotter, 7 times? And then he starts walking the 3 Jews, believers, Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego, and says, I'm walking with you towards the fire. Where is your God? I can't see your God. Is your God not saving you? And Shadrach says, Mr. King, we don't have to answer all these questions, but you have only one confession to make. We, our God is able to save us from your hands, and he will do it. And if he does not do that, he decides otherwise, we will never and we cannot bow and worship the golden image. Clear faith, clear representation of the throne of heaven. God will descend on people who agrees with the throne of heaven. What God thinks, think that way. What God would have you say, say that way. What the government of heaven is saying, represent it. Do not represent men. Do not represent the feelings, the desires, the lust of men, the systems of men. Represent Jehovah, whatever you call. And that's why sometimes we say, although we admire the cultures of the world, we don't deny some of them are good, but any culture that is in conflict with the truth of Jehovah must bow to God or be done away with. We are not slaves. We are God's children. If you go to Daniel chapter 6, Daniel is not thrown in the den of lion because of the same thing, not worshiping the idols. And something comes around. And the king, after throwing Daniel, comes on to check, is this man dead? Is this man dead? We put him there and put a seal. The king arises in the morning, verse 19. Daniel, did your God save you? And Daniel said, verse 21, O king, live forever. My God, verse 22, my God sent his angel and shut the lion's mouth so that they have not hurt me, because I was found innocent before him. And also, O king, I've done wrong. I've done no wrong for you. Hey, I want to say this, by the grace of God, we need to start now producing a direction of a representative of Jehovah so that God now can walk with you and appoint you as his ambassador, wherever you be, that you will be an instrument of honor where God can work and produce his glory as he did through Daniel and other believers in Babylon. That is very important by the grace of the living God. Another thing is, you need to clear two things. When Elijah was praying after the whole nation was misled by Ahab and especially Jezebel, the fallen heathen woman that the king brought into the palace, an antichrist, satanic idol worship Jezebel, when Elijah had anointing in obedience to God, confronted this system. If you read 1 Kings chapter 18 verse 21, the Bible says something. The Bible says, now look. That is, we are in 1 Kings chapter 18. We are in verse 21. 1 Kings chapter 18 verse 21. Bible says, and Elijah came to all the people and said, how long will you falter between, or you will waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. If Baal, the idol satanic God, is God, then follow him. People never answer the word. If you go further, the same chapter, you realize when now Elijah and all the false prophet of Baal met in the mountain, they agreed. They set an altar, put a bull there, but God, the true God, brings fire. The prophets of Baal prayed, used all the method to call on the idol gods, but there was no answer. But the time of Elijah came, and he said, please allow me to do my work. And Elijah said, God, answer me with fire, so that these people, you know, you are the only God in Israel. I am your servant. And whatever I'm doing, you are the one who sent me. God wants to produce, to vindicate his name. He wants to produce a testimony. He wants to confirm three things. He wants to confirm himself as the only true God, his prophet as the messenger, and the mission of his prophet as his work. You are the only God in Israel. I'm your prophet. And whatever I'm doing, you are the one who sent me. And brothers and sisters in the Lord, God wants to confirm that. If you go to that the same chapter, that's chapter 18, verse 43, there's what we call a wrestling player, wrestling. You are used to watching physical wrestling. There's another spiritual wrestling now we need to understand in the Bible. When after God answered with fire, and there was no people turned to God. So Ahab went up to eat and drink. Elijah went up to the mountain because Elijah knew the rain has not yet come. He went up to the top of a mountain and bowed down on the ground and put his face between his knees. That's a very powerful position, physical position. And he said to his servant, go up now. Look towards the sea. So he went up and looked and said, there's nothing. And seven times he said, go again. And then it came to pass the seventh time that he said, there is a cloud as small as man's hand rising out of the sea. So he said, go up. Said to Ahab, prepare your chariot, God down before the rain stops you. Now it happened. In the meantime, the sky became black with clouds and wind, and there was heavy rain. This is a contest whereby God is not, no one can compare or measure up with God. He comes to prove his name and to restore rain. And it's important, friends, for us to come to a place whereby in the calling and ministry, in all nations of this world, we raise an altar in every land that will cause people to stop wavering. We have left nations to waver, kings to waver, presidents to waver. We've left people to compromise under threats. No one can be able to threaten the power of God when it starts operating. When the power of God starts moving, raising the dead, healing the sick, performing miracles, no one will withstand that. People will just bow to God, even the evil people, and admit, truly, the God we need has come. If the Samaritan woman in the Bible, who portrayed the characteristics of a prostitute, would tell Jesus, "Jesus, we know when Messiah comes, he will tell us all things." Even in her evil life, that was not religious, evil life, deep in her heart, there was this desire for the nations. When Messiah comes, he will tell us all things. I believe in every person in this world, there is at the corner of the heart, people are still waiting for the true God, the Messiah, to be confirmed. And Christ said, "I am the Messiah." And the woman stopped all the stories, saying, "You are a Jew, I'm a Samaritan. We worship in the mountain, you worship whatever, Jacob." All the stories and all the differences, biases stopped. And the woman ran, saying, "Come and see a man who I confirm is the Messiah." We want to raise the altar of God in Kenya, in New York, in London, wherever, so that we can release a message. Come and see. The true God is at work in London. The true God is at work in Washington. The true God has been revealed in Nairobi, Johannesburg, everywhere. We need to clear the gospel, clear the way, clear the faith. There are so many faiths. We need to come up like Elijah and clear the faith. And the Lord, you help us in a mighty way for his own glory from now. We are still having other two messages about clear authority and position. We are going to stop there. And I want God to appoint you now like Elijah. Use you as you start firm for faith like Daniel. And now as I speak, receive that anointing. God confirms his name. God confirms his power. God confirms his work through you. I rebuke Satan. I cast the works of darkness in your life. Receive peace, grace, breakthrough, and blessings in Jesus' name.